السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم، من همزه ونفخه ونفثه. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى، وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. In the beginning and after praising Allah the Almighty alone and sending the best peace and blessings upon His most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I wanted to express my joy and delight, excessive delight for being amongst you today, and also thank you so much for the invitation. I truly appreciate that. Especially, I would like to give a special thanks to the host Al-Fanar and its administration, and also the brothers at the Sri Lankan Majlis. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us and bless us all, accept this humble effort from us. Allahumma ameen. Today, inshallah, we'll be speaking about the riba and its danger. And in the beginning, we'd like to establish a very important fact. This fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established in ayah number 157 of Surah Al-A'raf. In 156, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the story as follows. He says, Azza wa Jalla, وَاكْتُبْ لَنَا فِي هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً إِنَّا هُدَنَا إِلَيْكَ. اُكْتُبْ لَنَا فِي هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً is an invocation. This dua was made by Prophet Musa alayhi salam, when he begged Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, when the 70 disciples demanded to see Allah, so Allah destroyed them and they died with the shock. So he begged Allah to bring them back to life and they all repented. And he said, وَاكْتُبْ لَنَا فِي هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً إِنَّا هُدْنَا إِلَيْكَ. That means we repented unto you. وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ likewise, give us a goodly reward in the hereafter. قال عذابي أصيب به من أشاء ورحمتي وسعت كل شيء. So the ayah again. واكتب لنا في هذه الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة إنا هدنا إليك. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded by saying, قال عذابي أصيب به من أشاء. My torment I punish with whomever I will. ورحمتي وسعت كل شيء. While my mercy have encompassed everything, فَسَأَكْتُبُهَا لِلَّذِينَ يَتَّقُونَ. I shall ordain my mercy and grant it to those who fear me, وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِآيَاتِنَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. I shall give my mercy to al-muttaqeen, to those who give in charity and those who believe in my verses. What are their traits? And also the following ayah 157 will describe the traits of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as he was mentioned in the previous books, the Torah and in the Gospel. He said Azza wa Jalla in this ayah, which is the subject of matter, الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّيَّ الَّذِي يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدَهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ. I shall give my mercy and grant it to those who follow the Prophet, the Messenger, the Illiterate. These are his traits. الَّذِي يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدَهُمْ. The one whom they find his mention is written in the Torah and in the Gospel. What's mentioned about him? يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ ويحرم عليهم الخبائث ويضع عنهم إصرهم والأغلال التي كانت عليهم. Count with me. So Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم states, number one, يأمرهم بالمعروف. He shall enjoin them to do what's good. So every command of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is to do what's perfectly good. وينهاهم عن المنكر. And every prohibition that he made sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to stop us from whatever is evil. So every prohibited act eventually is evil, is bad. ويحل لهم الطيبات. And he shall make lawful to them everything which is طيب, good, healthy, beneficial, of use. ويحرم عليهم الخبائث. الخبائث is plural of خبيث, which is evil. And he shall make unlawful to them everything which is خبيث. So blindly, everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram is evil. Whether Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala justified that by mentioning the illa, the effective cause, why did he make it prohibited or not? The relationship between us as servants, as believers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is based on the fact that Allah is the creator and he knows best, and we are his slaves and servants and we know nothing. So we seek his guidance. When he says do, we do it because it is good. When he says don't, then we don't go near it because it is definitely evil, whether we can figure out the effective cause behind the prohibition or not. Every once in a while, there is a new discovery, whether scientific discovery, economical discovery. And these facts prove nothing but whatever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said was nothing but the truth and the ultimate truth. Subhanallah, for years people have been asking, why does your religion forbid gold for men? It's just a wedding ring. And some of the Muslims with weak iman, they question that. They say, I can just figure it out. Why is gold haram for men? What's wrong with men wearing silk? What's wrong is Allah said, don't. It's haram, whether you know a reason or not. Because Allah doesn't owe us an explanation behind every order. Or what kind of relationship is it? He's not your friend. He's not a human being like you. He is the creator. أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Doesn't the one who created knows best? Yes, indeed he does. And he is the subtle, the well-acquainted. Whenever I purchase this iPad, I have to read the manual, how to go about it, how to start it, how to turn it off, battery saving, all of that. Why? Because those who manufactured it and programmed it, they know better how to operate it, right? As creatures, Allah created us and He knows best what suits us most, what's good for us, and what's very harmful. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed us to do, to consume, to earn, to get involved in whatever is good and lawful. And He prohibited us and He ordered us from going near to the khabith. وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ وَيَضَعُ عَنْهُمْ إِصْرَهُمْ. And He will remove the burdens which were laid on them. For instance, the Jews. You know, at-tawbah before Islam was very complicated. Today was talking about one of the means of steadfastness is tawbah. It's to say, tubtu ila Allah, astaghfirullah al-azim, with sincere intention, done deal. Before, you know, these guys, Bani Israel, those who worship the calf, what happened to them? How did they repent? فَقُتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed their tawbah is by killing themselves. So those who did not worship the calf took their swords, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a fog or dust, and they started killing those who worshiped the calf. So one had killed his son or his father or his wife or his daughter, whatever. So the tawbah, in order to be accepted, was to be executed. In Islam, it's much simpler than that. With sincere repentance, you turn unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you say astaghfirullah, particularly in the last part of the night. That's it. Right? وَيَضَعُ عَنْهُمْ إِصْرَهُمْ وَالْأَغْلَالَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ. The remaining part of the ayah is very interesting. A promise. A promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created, who fashioned, who perfected, who knows best, who prescribed what's lawful and what's unlawful, who sent the messengers to inform us about what's good and what's bad. He said, فَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِهِ وَعَزَّرُوهُ ونصروه واتبعوا النور الذي أنزل معه أولئك هم المفلحون. Those who believe in him, follow him, support him and defend him and follow the guidance, the light which he brought with him. What kind of light did the Prophet bring? The Quran, right? That is the nur, to take people out of darkness into light via the Quran. Alif Lam Ra Kitabun Anzalnahu Ilayka Litukhrij An-Nasa Min Adh-Dhulumati Ila An-Nuri Bi-Idhni Rabbihim Ila Siratil Aziz Al-Hamid. That is the beginning of Surah Ibrahim. This book we have sent it unto you to drive people, to take people out of darkness into light by the leave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فالذين آمنوا به وعزروه ونصروه واتبعوا النور. And they followed strictly the nur, the light which he brought, الذي أنزل معه أولئك هم المفلحون. Such people will be the truly successful ones. What is the ultimate success? Is to follow strictly the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is to abstain from whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited. He did not say success where? Because it's general success. Success in life, success in this dunya, success in business, success in children, in choosing the right wife, in a married life, success in education, and most importantly, success in the hereafter by entering paradise safely. We agreed to this deal, brothers and sisters. We said we're going to make a deal in the beginning. We have to realize that everything that Allah made unlawful is definitely evil. Khabith. It must be avoided. Whether he has mentioned a reason or listed the effective cause behind the prohibition, such as in prohibiting alcohol and wine. He mentioned why intoxicants and gambling is haram. Why zina is haram? He didn't mention for gold. Why? And when he mentioned the prohibition of riba, which is the subject of our conversation, he said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَذَرُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنَ الرِّبَا إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. Oh, you who believe, fear Allah and abandon and give up all the remains and the different remaining forms of riba if you truly believe in him. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. If you don't, if you don't quit dealing with riba, then Allah, the Almighty and His Messenger are declaring a war against you. Who can afford to go to a war against Allah? Who can afford to have Allah's anger or curse be upon him? Whether an individual or a society, we are like an ant, an atom in this universe. Who can afford Allah's anger? No one. Okay. So, it is very obvious that the only way to salvation and success in this life and in the hereafter is in following the guidance of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In order to do that, sometimes the haram and halal mix up, and there will be like a gray area in between, and many people cannot differentiate between what's clear halal and what's haram. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, which is narrated by Nu'man ibn Bashir, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, he said, اجعلوا بينكم وبين الحرام سترة من الحلال. Very interesting. اجعلوا بينكم وبين الحرام سترة من الحلال. Make a barrier between you and the haram, and this barrier has got to be of some of the halal in order to avoid falling or indulging into the haram. It's like in the village, when a mice falls in the barrer, they don't just take it and throw it away. They have to take a little bit from the surrounding, which may be contaminated with the filth of this rotten animal or whatever, right? An oncologist, whenever a surgeon is removing a cancer, a malignant tumor does not only remove the malignant cells, but also takes some of the healthy cells to clean up the area. Doesn't take chances. Maybe a cell of the infected ones will be here or there. So he takes off the healthy ones as well and removes it. That is the meaning of اجعلوا بينكم وبين الحرام سترة من الحلال. It was also Nu'man ibn Bashir who narrated the very famous hadith, which is considered like one quarter of the deen and the fiqh. إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنْ وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنْ وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ. Hey, the halal is very clear and obvious. Everybody knows what's halal and everybody knows what's haram. It's very clear and obvious. But yet in between there is a gray area. وَبَيْنَهُمَا doubtful matters. Not too many people can figure them out. So what to do? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, فَمَنِ اتَّقَ الشُّبُهَاتِ فَقَدِ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعَرْضِهِ. Whoever would also avoid the doubtful matters has sought security for his religion, religious commitment, and for his honor, to remain in the safe side. Why? Because it determines your fate. It is not a game. It's not one-time error. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran said, يَا أَيُّهَا الرُّسُلُ كُلُوا مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَاعْمَلُوا صَالِحًا إِنِّي بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ عَلِيمٌ. And in another ayah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُلُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. O you who believe, eat from the lawful good things which we have provided for you. In the earlier one, يَا أَيُّهَا الرُّسُلُ, he called on the messengers, كُلُوا مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ, eat from the lawful and good things, وَاعْمَلُوا صَالِحًا, and do righteous deeds. Why? إِنِّي بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ عَلِيمٌ. I'm fully aware of that which you do. When the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, كُلُّ جَسَدٍ نَبَتَ مِنْ سُحْتٍ فَالنَّارُ أَوْلَى بِهِ. This is really scary. Everybody, every flesh which grew up from the haram, the fire of hell is more worthy with this flesh. Is it worth it? Is it worth it to destroy yourself and ruin your fate and eternal life because of eating haram? Bracing towards your provision which has already preordained for you? No, it is not. If you think that you can get away with this, not a chance. In the sound hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, لا تزول قدم عبد يوم القيامة حتى يسأل عن أربع. No one will be dismissed on the day of judgment. No one's feet would move a bit on the day of judgment before having to answer for four questions. One of these four questions, or those four questions, will be وعن ماله, about his wealth. And that entails two inquiries. How did you earn it? From halal or haram? And where and how did you spend it? So it's not only the earning and the spending. Al-malu malullah. It's his money. He entrusted you to look after it and to dispense it in a way that pleases him. So that's why not a single one of us will be dismissed on the day of judgment, whether he's a gatekeeper, a janitor, or a king. Everyone has to answer this very important question. How did you earn your money? Imagine the rich people have to answer for many questions then. And the richer you get, the longer will be the question. Imagine the audit from the moment you started earning. How did you earn it? From halal or haram? And how did you spend it? Many people believe that it's my money, I can do with it whatever I do with it. No, it is not true. You are only allowed to dispense it in a way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala approves. I just want to give you an example. Many people belittle the evil act of smoking. They say, well, many shaykh said it's just makruh. Makruh means disliked. يعني it is not a big sin. You will not be punished for it. I want to ask them this question. In the light of the hadith, You will have to answer for every penny. How did you earn it and where did you spend it? Buying a pack of cigarettes, isn't it spending? Spending, right? A lot of people waste 100, 200, 300 dirham or riyal or a dollar a month on cigarette. How are you going to answer this question? Was it a good thing? Or were you spending this money to develop a lung cancer and to hurt others? Well, if it is evil, then you gotta stop it because you don't have an answer to this question. It's terrible. By analogy, everything, every spending and every earning. Eating from halal is the way to salvation. Al-Hasan al-Basri, may Allah have mercy on him. You know Al-Hasan al-Basri. Said once in a majlis, all what I desire is one raghif, loaf of bread, prata, from halal, from 100% halal. The audience was surprised. What are you going to do with only one loaf of bread? One prata, what are you going to do with it? He said, I'm going to roast it, dry it up, then grind it into fine powder, then pour some water on it and make it a medicine. Make it a medicine. Yeah. If somebody's eye is aching, I will give him with a drop. If somebody's sick, I will give him a few drops of this. They said, why? He said, because al-halal is a cure. The pure halal is a cure. When al-Imam al-Shafi'i visited Ahmad ibn Hanbal, may Allah have mercy on him, his daughter, not that Imam al-Shafi'i, the guy whom everybody is talking about him, he's very righteous, he's a descendant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's a big hafiz. She said, when we served the food, he ate it all. So Imam Ahmad asked him, my daughter has a question, that you seem very hungry. He said, no, as a matter of fact, I had eaten it all because I have been informed that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the food of the righteous people is a shifa because it's from halal. There is a reason. Let me see who's inviting me tonight. It is halal. كُلُّ جَسَدٍ نَبَتَ مِنْ سُحْتِ فَالنَّارُ أَوْلَ بِهِ. That's why Abu Bakr al-Siddiq رضي الله عنه wouldn't put a bite in his mouth before knowing the source of this bite. So one day he was starving, he sent his servant to get him something to eat. So he brought him the food without asking, he started eating the dates or whatever. In the middle of the meal, his servant said, I wonder, this time he never asked me, where did he get the money? How did he buy the food? He said, yeah, how? I was just hungry. He said, in jahiliyyah, this is before Islam, before I repented, I used to trick people and act as a fortune teller, a soothsayer, tell them the future, trick them, they pay me money and so on. تَكَهَنْتُ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. So this is the money which I have earned before Islam. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, having known that the food which entered into his stomach has a shubha, a doubt of haram, even though it was before Islam, he stuffed his index finger in his esophagus and he started throwing up until he is about to take out his stomach. He doesn't want any haram to nourish his body, to stay in his stomach. Thus, we cannot make the decision and say, but too many buts. Ya Shaykh, I've been working for many years like that. I cannot quit and the kids and the school and the kind of life I've lived. You don't know what you're missing. You're missing the barakah. Riba or haram, whatever any mean of haram, destroys your wealth, ruins your health, destroys your children and your family. Why? Because there is no barakah in it. It is haram. In one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this hadith is narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, and is judged as a sound hadith by Sheikh al-Albani, may Allah have mercy on him. He said, الربا وإن كثر فعاقبته إلى قلة. You may think that the riba, the interest that is accumulated in your bank account because of the revenue on your saving in the bank, would increase your wealth. No, rather it will demolish it. يمحق الله الربا ويربي الصدقات. Allah will destroy the riba and will destroy those who eat riba and will ruin their lives because they challenged Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is enough to know that those who eat from haram lose the sweetness of iman. They cannot taste the Quran. They don't enjoy their prayer. They keep saying, Ya Shaykh, how come I cannot have khushu' in salah? Ask yourself about your earning. What do you do for a living? How do you earn your money? You eat in haram and you want to enjoy your prayer? You eat in haram and you want to ponder and understand the Quran? You eat in haram and you went for umrah from haram and for hajj from haram and you want Allah to accept your ibadah? How? إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبٌ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبٌ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. Allah is good and He only accepts that which is good. Now, unfortunately, it's a fact that the haram has become so widespread to the extent that it's hard to avoid it. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam predicted, collected al-Imam al-Bukhari wa Ahmad in his Musnad that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَيَأْتِيَنَّ عَلَى النَّاسِ زَمَانٌ لَا يُبَالِ الْمَرْءُ بِمَا أَخَذَ الْمَالِ أَمِنْ حَلَالٍ أَمْ مِنْ حَرَامٍ. He said, the time shall come where people during this time wouldn't even care. How do they earn their money? Halal, haram, it doesn't matter. What matters is the amount, the quantity. They have their bank card, their checkbook, and fat bank balance, that's it. They wouldn't mind whether their earning is from halal or haram. I believe we're living in this time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. The Quran has discussed riba in several places, all of them in disgrace and in curse. Take for instance the following ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah, ending up with the last ayah to be revealed in the entire Quran. In ayah number 257, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَى لَا يَقُومُونَ إِلَّا كَمَا يَقُومُ الَّذِي يَتَخَبَّطُهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنَ الْمَسِّ ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَالُوا إِنَّمَا الْبَيْعُ مِثْلُ الرِّبَى وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى فَمَنْ جَاءَهُ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّنْ رَبِّهِ فَانْتَهَى فَلَهُ مَا سَلَفَ وَأَمْرُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَمَنْ عَادَ فَأُولَئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَى. The word يَأْكُل from أَكْل to eat. So, we don't really eat the riba, but we earn, people who earn from riba, they buy food, they buy clothes, they buy whatever, so they end up consuming this unlawful earning. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the long story short. Those who eat from riba, لا يقومون, on the day of judgment, they will not be standing, they will not rise up, but like those who have been beaten up by the shaitan, like they are insane. You know how, may Allah protect us, if somebody is in seizure, an epileptic patient for instance, or somebody who's having those fits, so on the day of judgment, they will rise up like that. Why? Because they will recognize their grave error and mistake. They have been eating from riba. لا يقومون إلا كما يقوم الذي يتخبطه الشيطان من المس. Why? Because they said, there is no difference between trade and business and riba. It's all business. A lot of Muslims, they say, well, bro, it's business. There is no haram and halal in business. As long as it is legal, then it's okay. No. Only whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it legal, not the man-made law. If Allah makes it lawful, then it's lawful. Other than that, look at the punishment. So if one was advised with this admonition, then he seized فله ما سلف. If he didn't know before that it was haram, or he was reminded and he quit, Allah will pardon him for the past. وَمَنْ عَادَ And his matter will be up to Allah, of course. But the person who returns back to deal with riba, knowingly, فَأُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ Such people will be the dwellers of fire, they shall reside there forever. Because they challenge Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud narrated, when he feels sorry for a person who earns from haram. Then he dies. He neither took the money with him, nor did he enjoy it. Rather, he left it behind. So his family would enjoy it, and he will be held accountable for it. He will have to answer for every penny he has earned. Even in his life, if he decided to get rid of it entirely by giving it in a charity, it will not be accepted, because Allah does not accept what's earned unlawfully or a sadaqah from haram. The following ayah, ayah number 276 of Surah Al-Baqarah. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى وَيُرْبِي الصَّدَقَاتِ والله لا يحب كل كفار أثيم يمحق الله الربا Allah will destroy any earning that is riba based. There will not be any baraka in it. If it seems as it is growing, this is a malignant growth. Basically, it will destroy the whole thing. While on the other hand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enlarges and magnifies the word for the sadaqah, for the charity. What is the comparison? Why Allah compared between al-riba and al-sadaqah? Because in the case of the riba, the person intends to have an increase in his wealth illegally via taking advantage of the need of the poor. Who borrows? Normally the one who's in need. And that's why he agrees to pay this interest to the rich people who sit back and do nothing but they keep lending their money and collecting interest on that. This is the same theory of the banking system since even before Islam, since the beginning. Riba is prohibited in Christianity, riba is prohibited in Judaism. Only in the Old Testament I read that they have altered their book and they say it is prohibited to deal with riba with a Jew like you. But it is okay to charge interest if you end up lending a non-Jewish person. While in Christianity, it doesn't make any distinction. It is absolutely illegal. And Martin Luther King have written a little message or a booklet about this where he agreed entirely to the Islamic doctrine pertaining, prohibiting the interest-based transaction or riba and how it destroys the society and it widens the gap between the rich, they get richer, and the poor, they keep getting poorer and poorer and poorer. A very interesting thing happened a couple years ago when the stock market crashed in America. As you all know that since the brothers say in the name of gold, yeah, people, some people live only for money. And their dreams revolve around one thing, money, material. They send their kids to particular schools and they keep injecting them with the same thoughts. Honey, you have to be an MD. Why? Because you earn a lot, you can buy your house, you can fulfill your dreams. It's all about money. Well, that would not even count the least, unless if it was done properly, towards your fate on the hereafter, of course. So, in order to achieve this ultimate dream of theirs, a nice house in a nice neighborhood, a good job, a decent income, getting rich, having people to open the door for you, and so on, they don't mind. Halal, haram, it doesn't matter. What happened to the mortgage crisis in America? Hundreds of thousands of people, millions of people, who've thought that they have fulfilled their dream by buying houses in America. When the mortgage crisis started, they found themselves and the stock market crashed, they found themselves living for the past 10, 20, maybe 30 years paying nothing but the interest on the mortgage. And now the value of their houses, because the real estate value have dropped tremendously, dropped to one half and one quarter, and the bank either have to take the charge, the monthly payment, or they have to reclaim the house. So when they looked at their houses have no value versus what they owe the mortgage, they decided to get out. And you know what they did? You know in Surah Al-Hashr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking about Yahud Khaybar, يُخْرِبُونَ بُيُوتَهُمْ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ وَأَيْدِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. They were destroying and demolishing their houses by their own hands. These guys would take the hammer and will destroy the sheet rocks, the walls, the vent system. They would destroy the kitchens, the marble, the floors, the bathrooms. Why? Revenge. You want to take the house? Take it. Tuck, tuck, tuck. They demolished their houses. They took the light out. They left it as a piece of junk. I have been paying for 20, 25 years, 30 years, and I don't own a house. I have paid double and triple the price of the house, and I don't own a house. Yeah. يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى وَيُرْبِ الصَّدَقَاتِ. George W. Bush, in the last few days in his office before stepping out, he signed a bill of reducing the interest on the mortgage to 0% to encourage people to buy houses. And zero? Well, this is what Islam is calling to. This is what the Sharia is talking about. Zero interest. This is the Islamic way. So willingly or unwillingly, they resort back to the divine prescription, the divine legislation, because Allah knows best. أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 278, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَذَرُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنَ الرِّبَى إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا. If you do not stop dealing with riba, فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. The word harb means a war. Allah declares a war against you. Whether an individual or a society, a whole society can collapse overnight, as we have seen. Can file for bankruptcy. A whole nation can bankrupt. Why? It's all because of riba. They don't get it. Look, the widespread of STDs, sexual transmitted diseases. Why? Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not just send down the punishment for nothing. Rather, he says, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَىٰ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. If the people who live on earth, the villagers or the people of the city have believed and feared Allah and followed His guidance, Allah would have provided them abundantly from the heavens and the earth. Rather, they were rebellious. So Allah sees them with His punishment. The widespread of sexual transmitted diseases because of also deviating from the safe path, opening doors for illegal relationships, illicit relationships. They teach it in pathology and so on, they say, for having multiple partners. Multiple partners, in Islam we call it zina. And the homosexual relationship we call it luwat. We have to give things their proper names. It's adultery, it's fornication. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, whenever these evil practices spread in any nation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would afflict them with diseases, with ailments which they were not known before. This is a promise which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfills whenever we fall into that pit. Then finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 281, and this is the last ayah to be revealed in the entire Quran. After He spoke about the prohibition of riba and warning against, challenging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lest He will wage a war against you, He said, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Fear a day on which you shall return unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How long are you going to live in this life? 50, 60, 70, 100 years, and then what's next? You're going back to Him. Is it worth it to ruin your future for a few years? You never know how long will you live. ثم توفى كل نفس ما كسبت وهم لا يظلمون. On that day, every soul shall be paid on full, and no one will be wronged and odd. The good for good and the bad for bad. When Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated, as the hadith is collected by al-Bukhari and others, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ta'isa abdu al-dinar, ta'isa abdu al-dirham, ta'isa abdu al-khamisa, ta'isa abdu al-qatifa, ta'isa wa antakas, wa idha shika falan taqash. What does it mean? An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is invoking Allah against those who enslave themselves to the material in the form of dinar, dirham, gold, silver, in the name of gold. Yeah, there are people who worship the material. They believe only in money, in the material. Gold, silver, yal, dinar, dirham. Ta'isa abdul al-qatifa. These are different fabrics of silk. Qatifa, al-khamisa. Ta'isa wa antakas. May he lose. Wa idha shika falan taqash. A shawka, the prick that penetrates somebody's skin. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, praying again is this person who enslaves himself to the material. May he not survive. May he not feel better even if a thorn enters his skin. May he not be able to take it out. To that extent, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is praying again is this person, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to destroy him. Because in fact, a lot of people have enslaved themselves to the dunya, to the material. And that's why they don't think about halal and haram. They don't think about halal and haram. They only focus on one thing, how to get rich. They call it different way. They say, how to secure my future. This is not securing the future. This is ruining your present, your future, and the future of your children as well. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى. Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى آكِلَهُ وَمُؤْكِلَهُ وَكَاتِبَهُ وَشَاهِدَيْهِ. Count with me. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may Allah curse the riba and the person who charges riba, interest, and the person who pays willingly riba, and the person who writes down the contract of riba based on transaction, and those who witness such contract, everyone who's involved directly or indirectly in the business of riba, have been cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And al-la'n, to be expelled from Allah's mercy. Who would like to be expelled from Allah's mercy? Who can afford Allah's anger? For what? It's hard to comprehend that somebody who believes that the risk is in Allah's hands and Allah is ar-razzaq, dhul quwwati al-mateen. Meanwhile, he challenges him in ar-rizq and he says, I know better. I can earn my living in a better way. Or I can make my living in a better way. No, you can't. You will never, ever manage to earn a single bite or a sip of drink which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not ordained for you. If you work 24/7, if you work 28 hours a day, there's no 28 hours, but if you don't sleep, you're not gonna make anything extra more than what Allah has already preordained for you. I'd like to explain the different types of riba, because many people think a riba is to charge interest when you deposit your money in the bank. This is one of the forms of riba. But there are a couple of main forms or categories for riba. The first one is known as riba al-fadl. Al-fadl means an increase. That applies to certain items which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had mentioned in a hadith which is collected by Imam Muslim and narrated by Ubadah ibn al-Samit radiyallahu anhu. He said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-zahabu bil-zahab, wal-fiddatu bil-fiddati." والبر بالبر والشعير بالشعير والتمر بالتمر والملح بالملح مثلا بمثل سواء بسواء يدا بيد. فإذا اختلفت هذه الأصناف فبيعوا كيف شئتم إذا كان يدا بيد. What does this mean? النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم listed 7 items which people rely on most in their livelihood, in their food consumption. Gold, silver, dates, barley, wheat, and salt. He said, if you ever trade any of these items with the same, then it must be the same amount and in the same sitting, hand to hand. يعني if you're exchanging gold for gold, it isn't right to say, take that much gold and give me an equivalent amount next day or an hour later. So there is riba even in the time difference. If the currency is the same, gold for gold, then hand to hand. And the amount. And guess what? Most of our wives fall into this kind of riba unknowingly. When they go to the jewelry shop to exchange their old gold and jewel for the new one, what happens? He takes 100 grams for instance, and because hers is old, and he gives her the new 80 or 75 grams or 70. Why? Because of the difference. This is gold. This is the manufacturing. This is a typical kind of riba. Gold for gold, it must be 100 gram for 100 gram. My Sheikh, this is old, but it's gold. It has the same value. So what to do? What is the way out? Sell your gold first, the old one, for whatever amount in cash. Hand to hand. Then buy the new gold with a different transaction. If you ever exchange gold for gold, it must be the same amount. The quality doesn't matter. This is gold. Silver for silver. Barley for barley. Wheat for wheat. You cannot give a half pound extra. It must be the same amount. Because this kind of business was very common before Islam. So Islam came to stop this so that the poor would not be taken advantage of. And the rich wouldn't just keep getting richer without doing anything. Rather keep balance in the society. That's called riba al-fadl, an increase. Okay? And also an increase in the amount and in the time. There is no delay. But if the items are different, gold for silver, then it doesn't matter because gold is much more precious than silver. So the amount doesn't have to be the same. But it must be in the same sitting, hand to hand. يعني when you take your dinar or dirham and exchange it for ruby, two different currencies, that's fine. He gives you for a dinar, 3 or 4 or 5 rubies, or 1,000, it doesn't matter. But it must be the transaction at the same time. Hand to hand, because this is money and this is money. These are some of the applications of riba, which many people are not aware of. Whilst we all have to do these things, our wives keep changing their gold for a newer model, a newer fashion, and they fall into this business, which is haram. We exchange currency, so we have to be aware of this. The second category of riba is known as riba al-nasa or al-nasi'a, which is when you lend somebody money or when you borrow, you collect it. The lender or the debtor will collect his capital sum in addition to a fa'ida or interest. This increase is called riba, and this is haram. The fiqh rule is, كُلُّ قَرْضٍ جَرَّ نَفْعًا فَهُوَ riba. Every loan, every lending, which is accompanied with interest, is riba. With an increase, then it is riba. As long as it was agreed upon the increase, it doesn't matter whether the interest rate is 10%, 5%, or even 0.1%. Any increase is riba. Any increase is riba. But there is another legal form which people may confuse with riba. If you borrowed 1,000 dinar from somebody because you're in need, and he said, this is qardun hasan, a goodly loan. I ain't charging you anything. He took the money, he finished your business, and on time you're paying back, and you bought him a gift. You wanted to compliment him. It was not agreed upon it. It was not in the deal. Or you give him extra money, that is valid. That's a compliment. Because it's coming from you out of goodwill. It was not that he was taking advantage of your needs. The Prophet ﷺ had a Yahudi who lent him some dates, and he came to ask for it, and Umar al-Khattab wanted to beat him up. So he said, no, that's his right. Give him whatever we took from him and give him that much extra. So giving the extra, as long as he was not agreed upon it, is permissible. The danger of riba, number one, people will be dealt with, those who deal with riba will be dealt with on the opposite, on the contrary of their intent. They intended to live a happy life. They intended to live a luxurious life, to get rich. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish them with the opposite. Depression, suicide, poverty, recession. And this is all happening all over simply because of dealing with riba. Yesterday, I discussed at the university the CNN report about the rise in the suicide rate amongst American millionaires simply due to the collapse of the stock market. People who are used to a specific standard of life or level, they cannot afford to live otherwise. For them, money is everything in the name of money. So if they don't have it, they take their lives. Why? Because they don't have the same, or they did not fulfill their dream. While we perfectly know, alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests His servants in this life with poverty as well as with richness. He says, Azza wa Jalla in Surah Al-Anbiya, وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةِ وَإِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. We may try you and test you with what seems to be evil, what seems to be adversity and bad, as well as with what's good. So Allah knows best. He tests some people with richness to see what they're going to do with their wealth. And He tests other people with poverty to check out on their patience and tolerance and see the reaction. The hadith I mentioned, that every person who's involved in riba will be accursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is really scary for the bankers. The bankers. And everyone who's involved in setting up even the software of a conventional bank. An accountant who goes to audit their accounts. You're involved in riba. You document that. You witness it. You write down the contract. You say to the client, sign here please. You're nothing but clerk. You make him sign here. You included in the curse. إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا حَرَّمَ شَيْئًا حَرَّمَ السُّبُلَ الْمُؤَدِّيَةَ إِلَيْهِ. Whenever Allah prohibits anything, He also prohibits anything that leads to it. And in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. You should not assist each other nor cooperate in doing what's sin, what's ma'asiyah and transgression. Al-riba and dealing with interest is amongst the destructive sins. Not only destruction for wealth, but for the hasanat as well. in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, اجتنبوا السبع الموبقات. Avoid the seven destructive sins. He counted the shirk. He counted being undutiful to your parents. He counted as-sihr, sorcery, murder, and he said, وَأَكْلُ الرِّبَى. Accepting or devouring riba. Destructive. Destructive to your good deeds. Destructive to your ibadah. Destructive to your health. And destructive to your wealth. Which you thought that it will give you an increase Rather, it would only give you a request, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. In one hadith, which is narrated by Samura, Ibn Jundub, may Allah be pleased with him, he said the Prophet ﷺ, whenever he used to finish the prayer, he would turn around and face us and say, who have seen a dream tonight? So I can interpret it for him. One night, he asked a question and nobody said anything. He said, but I have seen a dream. Then he shared with them the dream. He said that two men came and accompanied me and they took me to a journey to Jerusalem and so on. And in the middle of his story, he said, I saw a river of blood. The water running in this river was mere blood. And I saw a man was swimming in the middle of this river of blood. And there was another man on the shore having a pile of rocks or stones. And the swimmer, every time he tries to go to the bank, the person with the rock will throw him with a rock. And the other guy would open wide his mouth and would take it in his mouth and he would push him back to the river. Back and forth. He's trying to save himself. فَاغِرٌ فَادُوا like this. And the guy on the bank would throw him with a stone, it would fall in his mouth and would kick him back. So he asked, what is this? They said, and obviously these two men who accompanied the Prophet ﷺ were angels. He said, هَذَا أَكِلُ الرِّبَى. That will be the punishment of the one who used to eat riba fi dunya. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. يعني loss in this life and destruction in the hereafter. In the hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, درهم ربا يأكله الرجل وهو يعلم. This is a very tough hadith. والله درهم ربا يأكله الرجل وهو يعلم أشد عند الله من 36 زنية. This is a sound hadith. One dirham of riba a person may accept or take is worse than committing 36 zina. أشد عند الله من 36 زنية. Worse as far as the major sin and the punishment than getting involved in zina for 36 times. Somebody's attention may be diverted from the concept and said, why 36? It doesn't matter, even once. Number would not even matter. What matters is how evil, how terrible is dealing with riba, and this is one dirham. One dirham with riba. What about a banker? What about one whose entire wealth is being invested in riba? Some people think the money which is invested in the conventional banks, the only problem with this money is riba. No, this is just one of the problems. There could be another problem. Yes, of course. For instance, if somebody wanted to open a nightclub and he went to the bank and said, here is my history and credit score, I'm very good at it. I wanted to open a dancing hall or a nightclub or export or import wine. Can you guys support me? Can you give me $10 million? Yeah, of course. 10-12% interest, I don't mind. So your money is being used in the haram. Why? Because if they use riba, anything else is okay. It is a disaster, isn't it? And I played a very important part in this. Directly, I wouldn't say indirectly. Then, even in much stronger and severe warning, the Prophet ﷺ said, in the hadith which is narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud رضي الله عنه, قال صلى الله عليه وسلم الربا 73 بابا أيسرها مثل أن ينكح الرجل أمه والعياذ بالله. There are 73 types of zina. The least is similar to, it's an awful thing, like one having a relationship with his own mother. أن ينكح الرجل أمه, making zina with his mother. This is riba. And this is what all our societies and many of us are falling in. That's why, indeed, it deserves al-mahq. And it deserves, as we quoted the ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. You want to get rich? Don't deal with riba. You want to live happy? Abandon riba. You want your children to be good, righteous, and be dutiful to you? Don't spend on them from riba. Don't nourish their bodies from riba. Don't send them to schools from riba. Ya ikhwani, you know the Meccans, whenever they wanted to rebuild the Kaaba, that was even before Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was only 35 years old. So they decided to undo it because it was falling apart. And they made certain that they would not invest in building the Kaaba a penny that is earned unlawfully, and counted in a declaration form riba. So money which was earned from riba, no, you cannot invest it in building the Kaaba. I know a lot of people who go for Hajj simply from the riba. Would the Hajj be accepted? Of course not. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, if the person's earning is haram, and he puts on the ihram, وَضَعَ رِجْلَهُ فِي الْغَرْزِ, he started riding the mean of transportation, he says, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ لَبَّيْكَ. Allah will say, لَا لَبَّيْكَ وَلَا سَعْدَيْكَ. I don't want any لَبَّيْكَ from you. مَالُكَ حَرَامُ وَزَادُكَ حَرَامُ وَرَاحِلَتُكَ حَرَامُ. Your money is from haram. Your means of transportation is from haram. The taking is bought from haram. The food you're eating is from haram. لا لبيك ولا سعديك. Versus a person whose earning is lawful, then he sets his foot in the gharz and says, لبيك اللهم لبيك. A caller will answer him, say, لبيك وسعديك والخير بين يديك. مالك حلال وراحلتك حلال وزادك حلال وحجك مبرور. And your hajj will be accepted. It's hard to make the decision. It's hard to say, I'm halfway already and my kids are growing. But I want to assure you that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من ترك شيئا لله أبدله الله خيرا منه. Are you ready to sign up a deal with Allah? Are you ready to do business with the provider? Or you still want to settle down and do business with the shaitan? Huh? Go lowly and earthly and do business with the shaitan, which will not be profitable. الشيطان يعدكم الفقر ويأمركم بالفحشاء. This is what the shaitan does, brings poverty and persuades you to commit evil and فحشاء. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises, if you give up on anything that is haram for his sake, Allah will give you better than what you give up on for his sake. One of our brothers just reminded me with a story which I normally share in this regard, and I would not get bored of sharing. This is one of multiple stories in addition to via Ask Huda, and because of this story, I have a lot of people who called from Nigeria, from many countries, bankers, and they said, Ya Shaykh, ever since I heard this, I didn't know, I quit, and wallahi, wallahi, Allah is giving me an abundance from halal, and my life has become much happier. This member of our community in America was involved in selling beer and lotto tickets. Haram earning. He had a gas station where he used to sell this stuff on a side. He would come back and forth and ask me, And they keep telling him haram. Ya Sheikh, I had youngsters, my girls, my wife, and I don't have a degree. I don't know what to do. I said, it is not that you will do whatever you do. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who will direct you to do the right thing if you decide to abandon and quit the haram. One day in Ramadan, he prayed with us all night long. And he stayed until Fajr. His heart was very soft. And he asked me one more time. He said, Ya Sheikh, you know, if I quit this job, I won't be able to pay the bills. Me and my family will be in the street. I asked him one question. I said, what if you die right now? Who's going to feed your family? He said, Allah. I said, are you an idiot? Do you think that you are here feeding your family because you're alive, and when you die, Allah will take care of this? Allah is the one who's feeding you and feeding your family. Don't be naive. So this little reminder which Allah put on my tongue really touched his heart. He left. And a couple hours later, after he told me, even if I decide to get rid of the alcohol and the lotto tickets, I have to inform the companies, and it would take at least a month to come and collect their stuff. I said, Akhi, death does not wait. Death does not wait. And Malakul Maut does not seek permission. Does not send you an SMS and say, I'll be coming on this time and the date at this place. He just shows up and he takes his soul. You better be ready. The guy took this statement and he did not hesitate. While his iman was at all time high, he went and he returned again. He left around 6 a.m. He returned and he woke me up at 9 a.m. I was in i'tikaf. He said, Sheikh, give me a hug. I said, this man is crazy. Ya akhi, you just left. I wanted to sleep for a couple hours. He said, give me a hug. I gave him a hug. What is the matter? He said, Alhamdulillah, I threw everything out and I put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will provide for me. So he made my day. I give him a hug. And I told him, between me and him, now we better get ready. He said, for what? I said, for the test. Do you think simply because you threw out the wine and so on, Allah right away will make the heaven shower you with the gold and silver? You'll be tested. Because you've been in the haram for a while. Allah wants to see if you are sincere. He knows. But to test you to be qualified for His privilege. So subhanAllah, he went through several things. He was tested for a while. But in no time, in a few months, he went for a job that you cannot imagine. For landscaping business. As a worker. Then he learned the job. And he studied and he got a degree and he got a permit in this job. MashaAllah, MashaAllah, he owned his company. Last time, more than 40 people working for him. I believe now maybe more than, Allah knows, maybe 100. And several houses, several palaces, mashallah. He goes for Hajj every year, 5 stars. He takes his family for Hajj. I visited him a few times, mashallah. He's living in a life that not a single doctor in the community is living. As a matter of fact, I know that some of our colleagues, the doctors, are investing with him. He doesn't drive an older model car. It must be the year's model. Why? He made a business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. And I believe if he happened to listen to this story, he would not mind because it inspires others. وَالدَّالُ عَنُ الْخَيْرِ كَفَاعِلِهِ. There is literally countless stories like that. For the sake of time, I just satisfy with sharing with you this one single story to know that you have to change. You have to put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before it's too late. You should not hesitate. You should not say one day, because you never know whether you live until this one day will come or not. Race. Rush. فَإِن تُبْتُمْ فَلَكُمْ رُؤُوسُ أَمْوَالِكُمْ. Right now, if any of us is involved in any haram, we were talking about riba, there are other forms of haram. Right now, decide to quit. And make a sincere niyyah with tawbah and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely in your sujood to give you better than what you're involved in. Inna Allah هو الرزاق ذو القوة المتين ومن تاب تاب الله عليه whoever repents Allah will accept his repentance. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.